Hello, it's Dmitry and Surfalytics. And today I got one question about a person who has interviews for either data engineer or analysis engineer. And often companies they claim that they operate on petabyte scale, and they ask engineer, or like during the interview, they can ask you, okay, how you handle petabyte scale data sets and how what challenges you have, what tools you use, and so on and so on. So I think this reminds me of the story that you have some kind of like BI report, and inside BI report you want to have all line items. Business managers or business analysts, they want to have a kind of like each customer ID, each item ID in one huge spreadsheet that they can dump from the BI to Microsoft Excel or and on Google Sheets and analyze this. And I think the right answer here from my perspective, first of all, in your data warehouse, yeah, organizations, they can generate like tons of data. It could be beyond petabytes. Like, I don't know, some companies who have thousands of customers, they have different products, SaaS products, they have different systems to lock their usage, the security things, the marketing, right? So many different things. It could be beyond petabytes of data, especially over the time, right? Everyone tried to keep their data. Let's try to think together on this problem. Then you work analytics engineer, data engineer, or even BI engineer. Typically, we will think about some data store. And this is our data store, right? There is data coming in from different places and data coming out. So it's totally makes sense. Here, you can have any number of data, and you need to organize this data, make it queryable, transform it. And first of all, when we talk about like petabyte scale data, it doesn't mean you need to read all of it. Even like for me, the typical data warehouse now could be like over hundreds of terabytes. And obviously you don't want to scan this data. Even some tools like Databricks or Snowflake, they might able to give a try to scan lots and lots of data, but it will be very expensive. That's why you should answer this, yeah. Like our organization might have the size of the data, like petabytes or terabytes of data, but what we do? The first one, we'll mention that, yeah, it's batch process, right? And this batch process, then it probably runs every hour or every 24 hours. So with huge data sets, it's definitely beneficial to run it every hour, right? So we have bunch and it's like every hour. Every hour you take the raw data and push it into your data warehouse. For 1 hour of data, even for very huge data sets, it could be still like 100 gigabytes, but it's not even terabytes. And you can apply all kinds of transformations for your 1 hour data. And for example, while you're loading this at the staging, or maybe from your staging, you want to load it to the next layer or where you apply some kind of transformations. You can, for 1 hour of data, you can apply anything you want. And then you will use probably append mode. Especially this happening with events data, like clickstream data, the product usage logs. Those logs, they not changing in the history. They're just coming over, it's like flow of data, it's coming to you. And what you need to do, you take 1 hour of data, you can create a kind of partition, and then you stack this data on top of another, right? And another key word here will be the partition. So your partition, and if we talk about lakehouse, or if we talk about data lake, the partition means just the subfolder. You have one folder with your data, and subfolders, it's your partitions. And how you can organize, how the system organize, how's the data coming to this step before, right? It could be different, right? Usually it could be some kind of stream, it could be Kafka, it could be Kinesis, it could be even Hub in Azure and some other processes. But the idea that this could be stream coming. So here, so this is this process where we load the data. This could be like stream coming, Kafka, anything. And they usually will write, because now everyone operates in the cloud, but AWS, they they will write in S3 buckets, for example, right? In Azure, it's Azure Storage. In Google, it's like Google buckets. The data will be written there. Usually it's JSON or maybe Avro. If it's JSON, it's better to gzip. Or Avro is very good format for streaming and serialization. And deserialization data coming there. And basically it's created in this folder structure. You have your destination folder, but every hour it creates a new folder where it dumps the data. And then your batch coming to this folder every hour and pick up the last available folder. But also you can create mechanisms to track. So example, if somehow your batch job failed, then it has mechanism smart enough to know what partition it should take. Also, in case you need to do any kind of backfill, you can also operate for the backfill. This should be clear, like batch 1 hour, that is partition and appending mode. This is how it works in data lake, this is how it works in Lakehouse, the Spark, the Trina, all those big data tools. Another thing that I would like to mention is the challenges here, how you're gonna backfill data. Assuming you load 1 hour, takes like 10 minutes, and you load all the data into your data warehouse, you process it. But somehow the product team or any other team realize that they need to do some extra work on the data. And for you as a data person, it means you need to do backfill. The backfill is pretty big challenge nowadays because you literally need to do rewrite the data because in here, all the data is available, right? It could be petabytes of data. It could be 100 terabytes of data. If 1 hour is 100 gigabytes, you can multiply how much data you have, right? It means that you need to create some kind of loop process that will loop over hours and days. And it could be a simple Python loop where you have date, start, date, end, and then you will get list of iterations. The one iteration could be 1 day or 1 hour, and it's just going through these. And you can also collect the metadata, which partition you process, which not yet, to be able, in case of failure, you can quickly recover and start from the right point. Yeah, this is another challenge, backfill. Yeah, and of course the cost for this thing is extremely important. While you're doing 1 hour at a time, the cost is fine and manageable. But the one question challenge you have data here, you have data in your data warehouse or lakehouse, so you can like duplicate the data. Do you want to preserve data in the history to pay for the storage? Obviously yes, because in case of backfill, you need to still use this data. Sometimes it could be challenged that this data also could be replicated some other services and applications. This is also a challenge. Basically, the cost and scalability is very important. So as a data engineer, you need to think ahead. You need to forecast and the plan, how it's going to work, what expectations, how much data you expect to write here and process to here. Do you need any big fields? Well, and usually because it's could be semi-structured files, then you need also extra computational things to make it flatten it. And how you can make it more functional, right? If it's JSON with nested elements, you find your schema with 12 columns, and then you realize that your JSON is dynamic. It could be sometimes 12 columns, sometimes 25 columns. So that's why you can here in your data warehouse, you can leverage what we call medallion architecture, where it's the bronze, silver, and gold layers. So gold layers is the fact tables. The row is where your data is coming to here in your data warehouse. And then the silver is a traditional staging. So that's, for example, in row layer, you can organize your data and store it in the best available format. So nowadays, it's either delta. If we talk about Lakehouse, it's delta, or the delta, or another one, iceberg. Yeah, the iceberg. It could be just the bucket, because with append mode, you don't really care. For example, iceberg give you extra benefits to use your partitions structure. When you use bucket, it means you have Hive meta store. It's very limited. The iceberg more flexible. The delta is better also too. And this is how it works. If we talk about Snowflake, it means the Snowflake has this internal storage. You have two options, even more than two options nowadays in Snowflake, because you can create, assuming your data is here, right? So you can like can completely decouple your data warehouse layer between storage accounts and data lake itself. For example, here you can write the data with Kafka in Iceberg format. I think it has, and also the Snowflake support Iceberg managed tables. So you can probably have your stream, and also it has dynamic tables. I don't know how it works in production with big scale, but the idea that your stream can write directly to Snowflake in the format you need. It could be Iceberg, it could be dynamic table. Yeah, it's kind of like vendor lock, but still maybe save some time to you. And you should understand the difference. But back to Snowflake. Because Snowflake, if you have data here, you can, instead of pushing data to here, you can use external tables. External tables, it feels like the Snowflake compute clusters will just read this bucket. And the challenge, I think nowadays, if you have external table, you need to pay extra. I think it's Snowpipe service that will scan over all the time, like the partitions here, because by itself, the Snowflake doesn't know about new partitions, new folders. So that's why there is Snowpipe service running in background to scanning this all the time. That's another challenge. This is how it works. And with dbt, you can use dbt external package with Snowflake. That works really nice. So this is all about data engineering cases. If we talk about analytics engineering cases, that's different, because analytics engineer actually don't care about all things here. The analytics engineer caring what's happening here in data warehouse. Assuming there is tables in your silver layers, and then they're going to design their fuck tables or their star schema. So the biggest question they might have is the performance of BIs. Here we talk about the dashboard, right? With different visualizations, like what's the performance here? So analytics engineer or BI engineer, they can care first, this fuck table, is it performance? Like, do you want to create extract or is live connection, right? That's open to discussion, because live connection, you don't need to extract the data, you can just query. But if you query, what kind of partitions or maybe indexes, how you can optimize these to serve as a query? If you have drop-down filters for self-service, it means here in dimensional modeling, you need to optimize these star schema, for example, to work it very efficient way with the BI dashboard. But if you create extracts, very often I see people create Tableau extract, Power BI extract, with like trying to process terabytes of data, it's not going to work. It can crash just out of memories. Your goal is to make it smaller. It means even if you have 2 petabytes of data, your actual challenge, how to make this data set aggregated enough to make sure that it covers all business cases, but at the same time, it's efficient in terms of performance and cost effective. That's your biggest challenge. And then if there is any things related need for you to backfill this thing, like how you're going to do backfill, like lineage backwards, but also all the transformation happening here to here, right? For staging layer or bronze and silver, append mode works perfectly. But here, append doesn't work, because you for example, you have like customer sessions, you need to look up beyond like 1 month, 1 year to build there some metrics about customers, about purchase behavior, maybe order history. You need to do maybe like merge statements or update statements, and you need to use window functions. And again, you have here like terabytes of data, and you trying to use the window function against your terabytes of data. It might be the challenge for your cluster. It's either will be very expensive or even just out of the memory. And then how are you going to optimize this? How are you going to trying to make it small and efficient? Like, what's the minimum thing that you can process? If you have window function, you need to come with assumption, okay, we will look only like last 10 days for the customer sessions, because even if some customers have like updates a year ago, you don't need to overuse the data warehouse and the process for your window functions in ETL jobs for the whole year, every day, just trying to last 10 days. Those assumptions you can come, and this is also challenging. And the last challenge, because there are multiple roles like BI engineers, analytics engineers, data engineers, how you can collaborate together, because you can come up with data engineers, talk about how they can optimize their staging layers. Data engineers can talk with analytics engineers, what's the best way they can deliver data for them. Yeah, I think all of these will help you to answer. But honestly, for me, petabyte scale, it's more like buzzwords, how you handle big data. I mean, nowadays, all data is big. Doesn't matter if it's petabytes, terabytes. It's very relative how big the compute cluster you have. Is it small like Azure SQL? Or I think you're probably very limited, like with just terabytes. If it's Snowflake Databricks, you have more flexibility. But even if a Snowflake will process all your data, how much it will cost for you. You can use the biggest cluster or the biggest number of the nodes in the cluster in the virtual warehouse, but it will be so expensive, then it's probably, there's something wrong. That's why it should be the balance between to cover all use cases, the aggregations, and like how you're gonna do backfill. And probably here, this is the big, like your raw storage, usually in the cloud storage, that has actual petabytes here. And your goal, then you move to this, we could call it hot storage, but using for BI or maybe for machine learning, how you can optimize it and make them more efficient. Your main challenge, how to not process all petabytes of data. That's it.